All right, everybody, we are here. Dabs with Schmeans.
Can't hear me?
All right.
You can't?
No, we got you. You're in. You're live. Ladies and gentlemen, not only one of my favorite musicians in the world, one of my favorite people in the entire world, Oteil Burbridge.
What's up? We fixed that
up, man. We figured it out just in time, you know?
It just went to my phone. I was like, really? We have like 1 minute to go and this thing's not working.
It's all good. It all happens the way that it's meant to happen, right?
Yes, with me being the most stressed out as possible. It's like life with
well,
my kids.
Now, maybe it's a good time to sit back and I'll take a dab and relax for a second. Know that we got it. We're here. We finally made it. Hey! Uh-oh. It is Dabs with Shmeen. What do I have today? This is some Trop cookies, and it is an all like beautiful looking hat. You know, really fun stuff.
I just got my medical card, dude, in Florida.
Congratulations! He's fully legal. We're all fully legal here.
Yes,
it's a beautiful thing to have that you know off of your shoulders and.
It is, man. You know, I've been propagandized into being a criminal for most of my life. And it really did feel nice to go in and it says patient, Oteil Burbridge, patient number, prescription. I was like, I just feel bad for all the people still sitting in prison for nonviolent weed offenses while they've deemed it an essential business and will now deliver it to my house.
What a world we live in, huh? Ever changing.
LGBT support, the LGBT pen special they had going on.
It is Pride Month right now. And the Supreme Court, I think just temporarily ruled in their favor. Discrimination in the workplace, I believe.
Yeah. I think they're trying to throw us a bone with all this stuff going on, but I'll take it. You know? Jeez, man. Oh, boy. It's been a while since ball. I did one of those, baby.
Really fun. All right. So, man, let's just get right into it. Tell us about your life and your quarantine experience and how you've been feeling lately with everything that's been going on in the world, having to do with George Floyd and the protests and the ever-changing United States of America, which is what we are, right?
Yeah, seeking to be United States of America. Always, you know, yeah. Unity is a tough thing.
Sure is.
I don't know that you ever get it totally, you know. But, you know, we've had a good quarantine. You know, I think most people know that Jess and I both caught the virus in New York at that Brothers show at Madison Square Garden. And, a few friends of mine did that were at that and the Love Rock show, which I think was the next night. But ours was easy. I mean, I've had other flus that were a lot rougher on me than this one, but I think that's just a genetic like roulette wheel, you know?
Right. kind of like chicken pox. There's some people who get it all over, and then some people who don't really get it.
Yeah. So we had, and then both kids got it. And so we got it out of the way. You know, the scary part for me, like, I was still under that illusion, like, you know, what's mostly older people, you know, at the time. So I think I had a little bit of a false sense of security. But when Nigel got it, it really did a number on my brain, like just the paranoia, because he fell asleep on the couch at like 2:30 in the afternoon. It was super hot, fever. And all of a sudden I was like, what if it's not true and it does kill kids? And, you know, I just, it was working on me that night. But then he bounced back the next day. And Kavi had to cough for a really long time. I had to cough for a really long time. That was one thing that was different. The after effects were really long. But, you know, other than that, like, they've been having a great time. It's been driving us a little nuts because 2 and 5 it's hard. That's a hard.
I know it is just with 2, and it's driving me nuts. And you're 2 and 5.
Yeah, it's bananas. Like, your day can just be completely upside down in like 2 seconds. Like, what's going on? It just, you know. Like last night, I'm so sorry to everybody. I apologize to everybody, but it just, you know, it could just go off the rails so quick with those ages, you know. And but everybody's fine, and you know, we've really had a good time. You know, I've had a lot of time with the kids. I think it's gonna be rough on them.
Well, you know, when I go back
on the road, you know, whenever that.
Yeah, is. No, that's exactly what it's gonna be like. They're gonna be like, "You do what?
You're leaving for 2 weeks? What?" Yeah. So how's yours been? I know you've been enjoying that baby girl.
Yeah, totally. I just, you know, there's a part of me, because we also took him out of school, and so, you know, my wife worked, and so it's really like through the week, the big chunks of the time, it's daddy time, you know, which also means it's not make beats time or write music time or hang out and play with your friends time. And, you know, I miss all that stuff. I miss all of that freedom. But, you know, I see the light at the end of the tunnel, and obviously I'm extremely grateful for the time that I have right now. But, you know, it's all about finding balance in life. And, you know, it swings one way and it swings the other way. And now I'm starting to feel like, you know, I need to bring it back up.
I wonder if a lot of people aren't finding their natural equilibrium. I mean, some probably aren't seeing it that way. Some probably are like, this sucks. But I think I found like where I am, like without being forced to be anything, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I don't know if I've ever felt that really quite like this, you know?
People are asking if you're typing. They can hear.
No.
Click, 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 click.
I'm holding the phone with one hand. I do hear, like, it sounds almost like a static.
I hear it too.
I don't know what that is, but no, I am not typing.
Okay. Maybe it's just like web nonsense.
We're having really, really hard storms down here.
So wireless,
and my 4G is bad as it is, so I have to use wireless for phone calls, like wireless phone call. And it might be me. I mean, I've got all solid bars here, but we are having a mighty storm down here. Did you freeze? Are you still here?
No. I'm right here. I'm right here.
You froze up on me. Yeah. Nope.
Am I back? I'm back.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, good. Good. All right. Yeah, and what about after this COVID thing, or during this COVID thing, George Floyd happens. And I just, you know, want to know your experience being down in Florida, essentially. I know you're new there, and it's a very diverse state as far as views.
Well, we're like a little blue bubble in Florida, you know, but Trump's place is very close to our house, Mar-a-Lago or Mar-a-Lago, however you pronounce it.
Yeah.
So we're definitely, you know, see plenty of Trump stickers even in our little blue section. But I don't know. I mean, it's I think apparently, you know, you're always told kind of like just stay away from religion, politics, you know, on your Instagram. And I got off Facebook because I was getting in arguments and stuff and or just getting sucked into it. And so I just got off of it. Instagram seemed to be less of that. And I think when I started posting about what was going on, some fans DM me. It's like, wow, I mean, why are you so mad all of a sudden? You know, like it just seemed like a big shift for them. And I was like, I've been living with this my whole life. You know, I've actually just taking advantage of a time where nobody can say don't talk about it, you know? And it's been really transformative. I've had some amazing conversations. A lot of people don't even think, like, you know, just what it's like to grow up from as early as I can remember being afraid of the police. Like, so 5 maybe? 4? I don't know. But that's just a basic thing that I don't know. Well, I do know a lot of people don't have to deal with, you know, like just the fear of the police. So, you know, even a situation where like the police are going, okay, well, we're not coming to work. See how you like it. And I'm like, well, if I call the police, I'm scared because they're going to think it's me. What percentage of the time? And I'm like, I'm the one that called you, you know, so I don't want to call them, but, you know, I just hope I'm never in a situation where I have to deal with it. I don't think most people can understand what that's like. So while I don't want mayhem and no police, you know, if I'm afraid of the police, I'm like, well, there's half of my problem. Like, I got to deal with regular crime and then police crime. So if you take that out of it, then I just got to deal with the regular crime, you know? So it's a weird thing to like for this to be normal, and people are finally seeing that, you know, like, wow. I mean, it's taken so many of my fans, caught them off guard. I'm just like, you know, this guy's telling me, it's like, I can't believe you, because I said I don't feel safe here. I never have, you know.
Yeah.
And he was like, I find that really hard to believe. You know, this is one of the freest countries in the world. You're a lot safer here than this country or that country. And, you know, in Africa or whatever, you know, and this, you've done very well here. I would think you'd be very grateful to this country for how good it's been to you. And I'm like, tell all the people that are in jail for weed, which I was a target of, you know, right. Weed enemy target number one, you know, young black male. And then tell all the people that are still in jail for that stuff, you know, how free it is here while I'm getting it delivered to my house, because I just never got trapped into the system, you know? And so get out of here. You know, it's been a cat and mouse game my entire life, you know? So they just can't understand, you know. It's like I'm trying to help them, but at a certain point, I'm like, whatever. If you don't get it by now, like maybe when they bash your head in. And I think people seeing videos of white allies just getting the crap kicked out of them, you know, and they realize, like, yeah, that's what happens if you just let this go on. You're next, you know. It's always how it goes, like. So now I'm at the same time that I'm like super just sad and having to watch this stuff. A part of me is glad because I feel like it's about to be over. I'm like, you know what? This is the time we got to drive it all the way into the end zone. So part of me is not happy, but I feel a sense of relief, hopefully not false, that this is, we really can do it this time, you know, and it feels like it's not stopping. So I really appreciate your posts and stuff, man. All my friends, you know, all of my white allies in the struggle, man, I really appreciate the post, man, and not letting up. And like, I think there was you as post that was like, if you're tired of hearing about racism, think about the people how tired they are of experiencing it, like their whole lives. You've just been dealing with this for like a couple of months, you know. So
all I'm asking from people is to just listen to someone who's going through it on a daily basis. And I'm not trying to take away from your experiences, your bad experiences or anything like that. We're trying to just focus on this and how to fix this right now. Then we can move on to other things. All right.
They're all connected though. You know, like people, as somebody was like, well, you know, more white people get killed by black people. And I was like, yeah, let's talk about that. That's not happening. How many industrial countries that are allies? It ain't happening in Canada. It's not happening in Australia. It's not happening in England, France, Spain, Germany, Norway, Finland. Let's just keep going. Ain't white people getting killed like that by the cops? That's a problem. You know, like, I'm not saying it's fine for cops to kill white people, you know, unjustly, you know, like the numbers are staggering. Any other countries, like, what are you guys selling? Just like gun crazy, which we are. So I'd like to deal with both of them. You know, I like to deal with the economic fraud that we have as a system, because that perpetuates in the prison industrial complex and
100%,
you know, big pharma, like all these things are connected. They're connected to religion. They're connected. We can't talk about, you can't just like compartmentalize this stuff, right? So I do want to focus on Black Lives Matter. But it's connected to all these other conversations that need to happen. And these things need to change, or else the thing is it's not going to change. You can't just like reform the edges of it, you know? The system is built on this, and that's what it feeds off of, and that's what it perpetuates. And it's a scary thing, because people are like, well, what, do you just want to throw out the whole system? I'm like, yeah, it's from the 1700s, man. We don't even use the iPhone from like 6 years ago, you know? And we're using this document, like, let's start over, man. Surely we can think up something, you know, or just like do major surgery on it, like make it a bionic constitution where we just cut the leg off and replace it with, you know, a bionic leg, you know, just get rid of the electoral college, give up, like, you know, I don't know. I think it's so drastic that freaks people out, but it doesn't freak me out, because the alternative is what we have now, which is madness. It's madness that we accept it.
Yeah.
It's madness. People from other countries are like, so wait a minute, if you get COVID, you're going to have $1 million bill? Like, what? You know, it's insanity. We should have a revolution just over that alone. That's me. I'm, you know, my parents were Black Panther colored. You know, I'm like, yeah, sure. Let's dump the whole thing and start over. I'm not saying don't replace it with something, you know.
Yeah. Black Panthers in Washington, D.C.
Let's replace it with something better, but let's not be afraid to just be like, this is silly. This is insane.
And where are your parents from, D.C.?
New York. Bronx,
New York. Oh, they're from New York.
And they got out once they had Kofi. They were like, yeah, we got it. It was a little too crazy for
them. Wow. Like, you have to, are they still around?
Yeah. My dad's 89. He's going to be 90 next year.
ask him if he ever had a meeting in a bookstore called Now's the Time.
I'm sure. Is it one of those black bookstores? And
well, it was a very far left bookstore that my grandmother, Judy West, ran.
And wow, really?
Yeah. My grandmother did things with the Panthers as well.
Now, is this the same lady that you told me about at work with the Musicians Union, or was that your mom?
No, that's my grandmother. That's Judy.
That was her too.
She worked for the Musicians Union for like 30, 40 years, something like that. And the first time I ever met Bernard Purdy and Reuben Wilson, they all know who my grandmother is. And
I'm going to just die if my parents know your grandma.
Seize the Time, according to my sister. Not Now's the Time. Seize the Time bookstore. I see you out there, Sarah. Thank you.
It's called What's the Time?
Seize the Time.
Oh, Seize the Time. Yeah, I will ask them tonight for sure, because I bet they do. I mean, you know, that was their thing. Just like books.
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
Yeah. There was some dude, I should know the name of the library. I should be shot for not knowing it. But he had this library of just all these black history books, and it was, the library was actually his house, but a lot of people went there to use it as a library to study, you know. So all the leftist bookstores, I'm sure, and the black history bookstores, and yeah. I bet they do know her.
She's turning 97 this year.
Yeah, I'll ask him for sure. That's super cool.
Yeah, I'd actually like to get her on the show. Maybe one of these days I can make it happen. Just for a second. She's a unique human, and she might smoke with us on here. She's 97, yeah. She still blazes, you know. No, this is the truth. Maybe it's one of the secrets, one of her secrets.
My mom smoked with my nephews. I love it. I was like, do you realize I could not smoke with my grandmother, dude? They're like, no, we know. I was like, all right, I'm just saying, like, you know, this is really cool, man. You know? Get out of here. So it's cute.
Do you feel at all that this is affecting your music, your creativity in any way?
Well, I haven't had a lot of chance to play when I was doing those Live From Out There things for Ben, my manager. I did a bunch of tracks. It was really hard with the kids around. It was just tough because I don't have a studio space. We downsized when we moved to Florida, so I lost all my studio space. So it just toasted me doing all the tracks, you know. It didn't seem like a lot to everybody else, but it was like every song times three or however many instruments I played, plus then I had to do the video tracks also. So it was just a lot of work. And after those were done, I was just like, I'm not doing anymore right now. Like, I got to help just with the kids, and that's as much as I got right now. But I did feel like, I do feel like when I do play or sing or whatever, there's more behind it because of all this.
Wow.
You know, that all these feelings have energy and there, it definitely informs the music, you know, just as it comes out. And now I'm starting to... things are starting to smooth out a little bit, and I'm starting to get, you know, back to practicing and writing and doing a little bit more. So I know it's going to be heavier when we come back and play again. I know it is, man. It has no choice but to be heavier, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm sure you're feeling that too. Like, you know,
It's been a unique ride, that's for sure, of emotion and just my whole time at home here, and trying to want to help and feeling helpless at times and not knowing the right thing to say and trying to figure out what's best and how to talk to people and, you know, not necessarily insult them when you talk to them, or even on like my page, if I saw people start to insult each other, I just blocked that person. I just don't have time for that right now. I want it to be a discussion, but there has to be a level of respect, you know?
Yeah. I think I saw somewhere someone said, you know, I want to have a conversation, but actually I think it was on a Grateful Dead Reddit. Someone DM me or something and about Black Lives Matter, and whoever moderated it said, paraphrasing, but it was like, you know, I'm down with not agreeing, but any racist, any homophobic, any of that stuff, you're just going to be kicked off.
Yeah,
like we're not that these are not human rights are not negotiable. Like, you know, they have one qualification. They're a human. And that's it. So,
you know, I'll say that I'm lucky to have friends who force me into almost being creative. You know what I mean? They're just so creative out there and doing their thing that it's like you can't not catch it from them.
Yeah.
It's like, so I've been working on some let stuff here and there and trying to expand, like, man, this clicking is definitely something. I'll tell you that.
It sounds like static to me.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it's a little bit of weird feedback or something. Do you still hear it? I don't know.
I'm hearing it, but it sounds like I'm only, and maybe because of my microphone, but it sounds like I'm only hearing it when you talk. Like, yeah. Maybe it's if the level's too loud or something. I don't know. It doesn't sound too loud.
Check. 1, 2.
Is it still my clicking? Ear.
I don't know. I still hear clicks.
But
yeah. So I'm still working on stuff, but I'm not in like the flow that I was before this all happened. And I'm trying to get back into it. I think I'm getting back into it more this week. And you know, just trying to reach for the stars and get a little bit better every day. And
yeah.
Whether it be in my production or my writing or my playing something, you know, or my thoughts or piano or bass, or just get a little better at something, or my vocals, or how to record my vocals. You know, anything like
that. Yeah. I think you need to turn your vocal back up, man. I can't hear you as well now. Sorry.
Check. 1, 2. How about now? Now.
Yeah, and I can hear you good.
Yeah.
Because the other people might not be able to hear you as well either.
Okay.
Yeah, I wish I had that. I wish I had time like that or the space to really get into that. Makes me realize how much stuff I got done at the old house. I'm glad I made good use of the time. I wrote a lot of stuff then, but I think we're about to fix that soon here if we could just have some gigs again. Yeah.
So, man, you've done so many incredible gigs. You're such a versatile musician, being able to jump from genre to genre. What are your most fond memories of, let's say, of playing with the Colonel and playing with the Allman Brothers and playing with Dead & Co. And, you know, let's just tackle those three. And when you think of those now that you've had all this time off and you haven't played with any of those, I'm sure you've really reflected on a lot of those gigs and a lot of that playing. And you want to talk about any of those?
Yeah. Well, I think Colonel stuff, I think about so much because aside from the fact that he visits, you know, I was talking to somebody. We were riding bikes early in the morning. We ride bikes every morning. And there's this little spot in the natural preserve that ends up on this deck, and it's just totally covered in woods. I mean, you're just in the woods, like in this little paradise. And I was talking to him about the colonel, you know, and I just, you know, I said something, and all of a sudden this big branch just like crashed down, you know, like right at the moment that I was like exclaiming something. I was like, okay, colonel, you know. So he does that, you know, he'll cut the power off, mess with my amp, and I, you know. But he predicted all this, man. You know, I remember telling him when we first met, I was probably 24, 25, 26, somewhere in there. And I said, man, you saw everything and like got to hang out with these cats. Like, you know, he saw Howlin' Wolf. He saw everything, man, everything. You name it. I've never forget. I was like, okay, Bruce, hands down, what's the best live show you ever saw? Without missing a millisecond passing, he was like Little Richard and whatever year it was. He was just like, it was just so powerful that it didn't matter like what race you were, like what, you could have been a Martian and just been like, oh my God, look at the energy coming off this guy. You know, I just wasn't expecting that from him. You know, I was expecting maybe an old blues guy or one of the avant-garde jazz guys or, you know, but, you know, he just, and I said to him, I was like, you saw everything, man, when it was happening. You were there for the 60s and the 70s, all that. And I was like, what did I get? I got Ronald Reagan. That's what I got. And he said, Otto, when it comes around next time, it's going to make the 60s look like an intro. And I was like, wow. He said, the next one's going to be the big one. So you don't worry about what you missed because it's coming. And then he passed, you know. And then now, of course, I can look back and go, oh, man, he wasn't kidding. Like, this civil rights march is global, you know. Like, it's bigger than, remember when apartheid, I don't know, some people aren't old enough to remember when we brought down apartheid, just with boycotting, by the way, which is what people need to really do, is boycott. We could change all this in like 2-3 weeks if we all got together. Unity is the problem. But, you know, when we divested in apartheid, that was global, you know. And it brought them to their knees and it brought the system to its end, to its death. And this is bigger than that. So if we could just get everybody, you know, it's like, this is amazing. So it's, the revolution's here. Like, we just got to keep our foot on the gas, you know. And Bruce predicted all of that, you know. So I think about a lot of those times with him where he was really preparing me for this, you know. Musically and spiritually, whatever. Uh-oh, somebody's knocking here. Uh-oh. What's up? Oh, you got out of the bath? Okay, come on in. I'm going to move to the other room because my kids just got out of the bath.
One.
Yeah, come on. Look at my little beet boots.
Yeah. Oh, they got a climbing wall. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I want to climb.
Tabby can climb it all the way to the top now, and she's 2. Nigel, watch her and make sure she doesn't. Sorry. They're jamming out some African music here.
Beautiful.
Honey, I got to go in the other room because Nigel came in there. But yeah, those times with the colonel, man, that was just so, it was like, people always ask me if I dosed with the colonel. I was like, no way, man, never had to. Like, the colonel was acid. Like, you didn't need that, you know, at all. And it was just such a trip, man. It was just amazing. It was the most surreal, magic, you know, episode of my life. Like, he just was so psychic, and so like stuff would just happen around him. He was a true catalyst, you know. And he couldn't, well, he knew that he couldn't help it, but he also could wield it to a certain extent. Like, he could control it to a certain extent.
And it's a very unusual character, you know. Did he ever guess your birthday and all that stuff? You know, he got within 3 minutes of my birthday, you know.
It was really crazy because I had my doubts. Can you hear me? By the way, I'm going with this mic. Maybe it's better now. I don't know.
I can hear you, yeah.
Okay, good. And one day we were on Jam Cruise and I saw him at the other side of the hallway. You know, the small hallways that even have corridors down where like your rooms are. And I knew we were going to pass by. And I wanted to take him by surprise. So I pulled my hood over my head, right? And I'm walking down like this. And right when we got next to each other, I was like, "Hey, Colonel." And he was like, "Oh, Shmee, why you gotta do that to me, right?" And I was like, "When's my birthday, Colonel?" Right then and there, he's like, "Oh, you're gonna do this to me right now? What? I don't know. You're like a Scorpio or something." I'm a Scorpio. He's like, "I don't know. You're like late October." I'm late October. He's like, "You're like October 20th. He became like one day off of my birthday, right when I put him on the spot, and it hit me so hard, I fell to one knee. Because I was not a believer. I was not at the time. I was like, this has got to be all hooey. You know what I mean? And I didn't believe it. And then all of a sudden, it was like, no, this is real. This is so real. And I just felt it to my core. That was my experience.
He was real. I had him do like 5-6 people in a row. Some people got scared, man. There were some religious people that straight freaked out. They were like, "I'm not saying he can't do it. I'm saying I don't know why." You know, like they were not into it. And I just, you know, without knowing him, he could kind of be kind of scared of him. You know, he looked like a homeless guy half the time, you know.
It seemed to me that even he was scared of it a little bit.
Huh?
It seemed to me on some levels, even he was scared of it a little bit.
Well, Bruce, here's my theory on Bruce. You know, the strongest drug is hallucinogen is DMT, and we have it, right? And our, is it pineal gland or pituitary? It's one of our glands on our brain, you know? Okay. And I think it just gets released at extreme times, and this is when a lot of people have spiritual visions or whatever, visions of God. Say it gets released when you die. I think Bruce's was released, like the spigot was on more than the normal person. And I've seen him sometimes when he was scared, when I think his reality was like a super strong, like a DMT trip. And I would even ask him, I was like, "Are you okay?" He's like, "It's, you know, I'm all right." I was like, "Is it rough today?" He's like, "Yeah, it's a little rough, you know." But he was trained in it, but, you know, he didn't just like, it hit him all at once. I think he was like 9 years old or something when it all hit him. And he told me the experience when he was in a restaurant, you know, he just jumped up on the table at the restaurant. Was like, "You're all crazy, you know?" And he just like, people thought he was nuts, but he just had this extreme moment of clarity at like 9, like, oh, it just got red pilled somehow. I don't know what did it, but except for that he's an alien, you know. But he was taught by, you know, he found like souls, and I think that's why he gravitated towards people like Saint Om, and, you know, everyone from Saint Om to Sun Ra to Zappa to who, you know, like Ornette, all these. You know, they're just these alien people, you know. There's a lot of them, actually. I have fun spotting them now, you know. And so he learned to wield it, you know. He would even use it to gamble and stuff. Like, he knew what sign the horse was. You know, like, that horse was going to die 3/4 of the way through, Oto. The moon's in Sagittarius. He doesn't have a chance, you know. Like, okay, that's the lead horse that everybody is supposed to win. He bets on the other one. About 3/4 through the race, he goes, "Here it comes." And the lead horse just dies all of a sudden. And this other horse, it's a long shot, just takes off like a rocket. And I go to turn to Bruce to go, you're right. He's already getting up, walking to go collect his money. You know? So wow. He was a numbers freak like Rain Man, but just look at pages and pages of baseball stats and just like he just loved numbers and the cycles of it. Same with astrology. Like he saw it. It was just amazing how his brain worked, man. I've never met anyone like that. It seems like this cat can't do anything and he really could do whatever he wanted. He just had mystical power, you know, and he knew it and he learned it. I won't say control it but he learned to be able to use it effectively, you know, very effectively. So that whole, you know, having experience like that with someone like him is so far beyond music, you know, it's just, you know, my time with an alien, you know.
It's crazy. And then musically, everything switches up and you end up in the Allman Brothers band, right?
Well, check this out. Dwayne Allman is the guy that got Colonel Bruce his record deal on Capricorn. The first record, Music to Eat, which is a double album. And I think his finest work, I think it's his masterpiece.
And where can you hear that?
It's a collector's item. Nigel, I'm still on the phone. Sorry, sweetie. It's hard to find. But you could like pull it up on YouTube and listen to it.
You can.
Music to Eat by the Hampton Grease Band. And Phil Walden sold that record to Columbia Records and to Clive Davis. And so Colonel knew Dwayne and Dickie. And I think he knew J-Mo. And he was tight with Pigpen from the Grateful Dead. Because Pigpen's dad had a black radio show. And so they were like, you know, these white kids from the 50s that were all into this black music because you couldn't segregate a radio, you know. And so meeting him, really, I was into all this stuff. He was kind of surprised even some of the classical stuff that I knew, like, Christoph Penderecki, you know, which my dad turned me on to. My dad's like a musicologist. But what I didn't have was like the Delta Blues, the blues that sprang out of that, the Electric Blues, Chicago Blues, and all this stuff, you know, Texas blues that came out of that, and the bluegrass. And so getting that history and actually playing with those people, like Johnny Shines opened for the Aquarium Rescue Unit at the Cotton Club in Atlanta. This is a guy that toured with Robert Johnson. And I'm like, my mind is blown. I'm like, this guy toured with Robert Johnson. And I'm standing in the dressing room with him. I go in his dressing room, I talk to him. He's wearing these big old red polka dot boxers with suspenders. I forget why he's changing his clothes or something, you know. And I said, who's your favorite? What's your favorite musician? You know, he goes, well, somebody you probably wouldn't know, to be a man by the name of Charlie Christian, you know. And I was like, deep. We were getting so deep into Charlie Christian and Django Reinhardt at that time. Me and Matt Mundy, who was our mandolin player, who came from bluegrass, you know. And so, you know, I was having these kinds of experiences with the Colonel, and that having those kinds of things playing with, you know, him, and actually getting to play with Cedell Davis and cats like that, that are like modern blues men, like the old Delta guys are just around now. Just will have ghosts flying around the room. You'll be ducking like this because stuff will fly at your head. You'll see it physically, you know. It's not like nothing you've ever experienced, you know. And that prepared me for the Allman Brothers, of which there is a connection, you know, literally with Dwayne. And it also prepared me for the Grateful Dead, because I wouldn't be prepared to play those gigs without that stuff. I got the funk, I got the jazz, the gospel, you know, classical, rock, whatever, you know, but you need those. The New Orleans stuff, you know, but that bluegrass and that that old blues stuff, which really doesn't even have or need a bass player, but still you need to have that in there, you know. So without the Colonel, I wouldn't have been ready for those gigs. I would have been like an instrumental fusion guy somewhere, just having to play in Europe or live in Europe just so I could play that music, you know.
You did something too, which I don't see like a lot of musicians willing to do, which is you changed the bass that you played. You like all of a sudden really played like all of the parts, so respectful towards the music, but still put your own thing to it at the same time, in like the most respectful way, and just how you did that, I think is like, well, a lesson for a lot of young musicians.
I think, you know, for me, like with the Allman Brothers, I didn't even own a four string when I got that gig. I was so deep in the six string, and I would use a five string if I was gonna thump and slap, which is rare, you know, but it just wasn't quite right, you know. And I remember asking Joe Dan Petty, who was Dickie's guitar player since the very beginning of the Allman Brothers. I said, man, something just doesn't, like, I know I've got the right notes, but something just doesn't feel right. And Joe Dan's a bass player who recorded albums on Capricorn, I think. So he goes, oh, T, I'll never tell you how to play. I really respect you as a bass player, but if you don't mind, if I can make a suggestion. And I was like, fine. He just hands me this four string. I was like, okay. And then he pulls out a pick. He's like, would you be open to this? And I'm like, sure, I'll try anything, you know? So then I'd like pick up the four string. I play with a pick, like, boom. It's like, wow, that just fixed like 90% of it. Thanks, Joe Dan. So whenever I had a little thing, like the slightest thing, I would go to Joe Dan. Like with Leave My Blues at Home, there's this bass line. I was like, I know I've got the right notes. I got the four string. I got the pick. So I'm still
just curious, really quick. Felt, was it a felt pick?
No. Just regular. I think I just used like a Fender medium or whatever at that point. Right. I just tried to use those big triangle picks, yep. You know? And, he said, O'Teal, here's how Barry used to finger it. Now, Barry was a guitar player, so he would do a lot of stuff on the open strings, which I never play down there because I like to play off the open strings where the patterns always repeat themselves. And when he showed me this fingering, I never in a million years would have thought of that fingering because I just don't think like a guitar player playing at on the open strings. That's not the way I would play a pentatonic. To this day, I know that it works, but it doesn't make sense like how my brain works. It's not how I would see it. But as soon as I changed to that, it was like, boom. I was like, that's it, Jodan, you did it again. You know, thank you. So, you know, part of it is you got to want to get those things. And part of it is if you're lucky enough to have someone that can help you, help inform what happened way back at that point. The band was 30 years old or 28 years old. So he was there at the beginning. So he could tell me for a fact how it was going on because he's a bass player, even though he's Dickie's guitar tech. So he knew what Barry was doing. He knew everything Barry was doing, you know? And so that really helped. And then I just tried to like, look, these are bands that have long jam sections in the song. Play the song like Barry. If it's a defined bass line, play it like Barry. With Phil, there's less tunes with defined bass lines, but there are some, and I do them, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes even if he changed them later, you know. And but then on the jam section, it's Teely time, you know. Like, you're going to get about 32 bars and then, or 16, and then, it's time for me to do my thing, you know? So,
yeah.
And that's why.
What a great lesson for everyone out there doing other people's gigs, you know? Doing music where, you know, you have to play parts and and find ways of getting your own personality in it.
To me, it's like a preacher. You know, it's Mark 4:15-27. Now you got to read that the way it is. That's what it says. Now we expound on it. Then we do a sermon on it. That's my part, you know, but I got to read you the verse, the chapter and verse first, just so we know where we're starting out. So everybody's on the same page, you know, because I'm playing to the Allman Brothers fan that saw the original band, the guy that comes up to me and man, I saw him for $2 or I saw him for free, you know. I saw him at a high school gym when nobody knew who they were, you know, and you're killing it. So when somebody, if I win that guy over, you know, it's like the same with deadheads, man. When some old ass deadhead comes up to you and he's like, man, like sometimes I'll be going up and I just want to meet my friends that I have on the guest list and talk to them. I see some old deadhead come out. I'm like, look, we got to give him a minute because... And he'll just say, man, I've been seeing it since 69 or whatever year, you know, and I just got to tell you, I love what you're doing. That kind of thing gives you you can't even put a price on that. You can't even put a price on that because this music is sacred to the hardest fans. This is their religion, you know? So I got to treat it sacred, you know?
Beautifully put, man. Thank you. That's awesome.
Thank you. For sure.
Maybe open it up to a couple questions and then we'll call it a show. How about that? Does that sound good?
Sure.
All right. So I guess we got the little public chat window. We'll just see like whatever the first one whenever that interests you.
I can't see it, so I don't know. You pick it because I can't see it.
There's a little delay. I'll give it a second here. But if you have a question for OTL, now is the time to ask. And meanwhile, you know, thanks everyone for tuning in to another episode of Dabs with Shmeez.
Yeah. So sorry about yesterday, but man, if there's one podcast I want to do, it's this one, dude.
That's the great thing about Dabs with Shmeez. Really, they happen all the time. You know, this just happens to be the on-air version. all right. What was the name of the band you played in Virginia Beach?
It was called The Squares. We were a top 40 cover band. We played 5 nights a week on the beach. Like the club was on the beach. It wasn't like actually in the sand or whatever, but, man, it was like Huey Lewis in the News, Ghostbusters, you know, as soon as it went out of the top 40, we dropped it. Like, you know, we stayed
current.
Super current. Yeah. And it was just like, I remember thinking, God, everybody was like, saying this was going to be so hard, like, you know, making $500 a week. This is like 1983 or 4, something like that. And I was like, this is a breeze, man. What's so hard about the music biz, you know? After I moved to Atlanta, then I found out what was so hard about the music biz. But that was a great band, man. Billy Drummond, a great jazz drummer. Moved to New York and just played with everybody, man. And he was in that band. And that's where we met the Wooten Brothers. They were down there playing. And James Genus was down there. And Steve Wilson. All these cats, man. All these cats. There's a lot of heavy cats down there. So that was The Squares. I'm going to post a picture of that. I have a band picture of that. It was amazing.
Oh, I'd love to see that picture.
I have a big old Tom Selleck mustache.
Most of us musicians have all been in top 40 bands and cover bands and stuff like that. That's how we make our living. That's how we survive. Those are called the trenches. And, you know,
yeah,
that's where you really do your learning and creates your craft of what you do. You find them on those kind of gigs a lot of the time.
Yeah. I had fun because, you know, and that was the age of, like, everybody was doing sequenced bass lines.
Mm-hmm.
So all these cats were buying keyboards. I was like, I didn't do all this practicing to, like, play a keyboard with my two index fingers, like, you know. So that's when I bought a 5-string because all the keyboard bass parts were going lower than regular bass parts. And some of them were, like, sequenced. Like, I'll never forget this group called The System. And then also Al Jarreau had this tune. And like the bass line was like, so like, and you're playing this through the whole song. And that's how I kept my chops up. Like when I learned that line and came in and played it on the bass, because other people are like doing the sequence on a keyboard. Dude, the musicians in town were flipping out. Like, people in the audience didn't know any different, you know. But I was like, this will help me keep my chops up, my fusion chops up, you know? So I took advantage of it in that sense. And it was a smoking band. We were just doing these, you know, 80s pop tunes, which were, you know, not my favorite stuff. But we made it fun. Like the solo sections, we would just slam it, dude. We would like, and people came from all over to see us because we were going for it, man. We were going
for it. I'd come to see you. Miles away, wherever you play. Here's one. Your solo on Davy Crockett was amazing. It's blown my mind so many times. Did you have a favorite song to play with the Aquarium Rescue Unit?
I have a favorite solo. I can't listen to my solos on the first album because I was singing an octave above the note, like I hadn't figured it out. I just got the bass, you know. I hadn't had it that long. And then we cut this record, and it was live. So you just throw yourself off the cliff and, you know, just go. But that second record we did, while I liked the energy of the first record better because it was live, like the solos that I did on it, like on Thron Dasla or on Shoeless Joe, are some of my favorite recorded stuff besides like my solo records, you know. For sure, with ARU, those two would probably be my favorite. I used to love soloing on the ballads, and I still love that now. Like with Dead & Company, the ballads are my favorite to sing. The ballads are my favorite to solo over, though I don't get to with Dead & Company yet, you know.
I've heard people say that you sound the most like Jerry at times.
I sound way different than him, but I think it's probably just maybe coming from a similar emotional place. I don't know. Because when I hear him now, I'm just like, oh man, he just undoes me, you know. He's something.
Beautiful. Well, I think we'll call this a show.
Cool. My wife's ready for me to help
her.
I'm
sure she is. And, thank you so much for coming on again. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Another episode of Dabs with Shmeez.
Thank you, brother.
Here we go.
That's it, she's.